Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we're grateful we get to come into your house. This isn't a have to, God. This is a get to, Lord. We're excited and just honored to be in your presence, God. Thank you for what you've already done, Lord. We're just so blessed to be in your presence, to lift up your praise, lift our hearts and our hands to you, God. And now, Lord, as we open your word, we pray that you open it up to us. In fact, Lord, open us up to receive it. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown, and may it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. God, today, truly, it's not about us hearing from a man or a woman, from the young or the old, from the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. God, today, we have come together to hear from you. So be welcome in this place, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction we need, Lord. And we'll give you the praise and the glory for it. Father, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves. Also, we'd ask it for all the brothers and sisters in the Lord that are preaching and hearing the gospel, our Lord Jesus Christ today. God, we lift them up to you and pray that you would bless them as you would bless us, God. We bless all of our brothers and sisters. Bless the Baptists, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals. God, we thank you for Calvary Chapel, Harvest, for Oak Valley, for the Well on the Way, Ecclesia, Trinity, Emmanuel Baptist. God, too many churches to name by name, but God, if they're lifting up your truth, bless them, God. Bless Victory in the assemblies and the Foursquare denominations, God. We bless our Catholic brothers and sisters and Adventist brothers and sisters, God. If they're lifting up your name, preaching your gospel truth, Lord, we thank you that you would bless them this day as you bless us. Also, God, we don't forget our persecuted brothers and sisters scattered abroad throughout the world. We ask that you'd encourage them, strengthen them, protect them, provide for them, God, and lift their spirits, God. We thank you, Father God, that they will endure to the end and never give up on you, God, because you will never give up on them. Thank you for your presence and your blessing. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement. We say,
amen.
Amen. Today, get your Bibles out. Go with me once again to Hebrews. We are in Hebrews, the 11th chapter, screaming right along. It came to my attention, Pastor Joel told me that this weekend marks 5 years we have been in the book of Hebrews. So we're screaming right along, you know? Now, the Word of God is not meant to be fast food. This is not 30 seconds or less or your meal is free, okay? This is not meant to be something that we just devour and forget about right away. This is good food. This is fine dining. This is something that we're supposed to take time with and get every bit of goodness and life out of it that we can. Word of God will nourish your life and it will strengthen you and encourage you. Not just getting an overview or the general knowledge. That's not what this is about. This is not just a history lesson or some wonderful suggestions from the internet or something like that. This is the very Word of God for our lives. This is the character of God, the nature of God, the attributes of God, that as we see how God is and what he does and how he wants us to live, that we can apply these truths to our lives, and it changes every area of our life. Hebrews 11 chapter, we're in verse number 9 and verse number 10. Now, verse number 8, we were just in last week, talking about Abraham. And by faith, Abraham obeyed. Now, we're still talking about Abraham in verse number 9, and it says these words. It says, by faith, he dwelt in the land of promise, as in a foreign country, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. Verse number 10, for he waited for the city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. So here we see Abraham, and here we see something that he did. Not only by faith did he obey, but by faith he dwelt. Verse number 9, if we can go back there on the overheads, verse number 9 says this, by faith he dwelt. Now that word dwelt, I've highlighted it up on the overheads for you. If you look at the original translation, we understand dwelling, it's staying somewhere, living somewhere. But I think a better translation, as you look at the original language, would be that he sojourned, or he was just passing through, if you will. By faith, he sojourned in the land of promise, as in a foreign country. See, Abraham realized and recognized that even though God had promised that land to give it to him, even though he knew that everywhere he put the sole of his feet as he walked to and fro around it, that was not his home. That was not his permanent place, but that he was just on a journey passing through. And that's why he was dwelling in tents. Think about it this way. Abraham never had a plot of ground that he dug foundations and started to put brick and mortar down to build his house. No, he dwelt in tents with his children and with his grandchildren, with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. Because he understood something, that this is not permanent, this is only temporary. In fact, the only land that Abraham acquires while he was alive on the earth was a burial plot for him and his wife. That was it. So when I pass away, put my body right there. That's the only thing I own. And he had to pay money for it. See, because Abraham didn't look to the natural, didn't look to the now. He looked to his future. He recognized and realized he was dwelling in tents in a foreign country. See, Abraham was a stranger in a strange land. And for us today, that's actually the title of today's message, is being a stranger in a strange land. Abraham is called our father. He's the father of faith. And now as we believe in Jesus Christ and we enter into a covenant relationship with Jesus, giving him all of our heart and all of our life, and now there's that new life that's given to us, now we become heirs of that same promise. And so if we want to get the results that Abraham got and live a life of faith like Abraham did, then we can see some things in Abraham that as we apply them to our life, that we're going to be blessed and we're going to see the results that he got for each and every one of our lives. Today, I want to talk to you about how to dwell here in faith. See, because we're just passing through. We're all on a journey. None of us is doing anything that is of permanence here on the planet. You can build, you can acquire wealth, you can accumulate homes and land and stuff, right? And yet, we don't get to take any of it with us. I heard of a man who was buried in his Cadillac. Can I tell you something? That's a waste of a perfectly good Cadillac. He's not using it. Somebody could be driving that thing right now. Listen, you're not even going to get to take the gold fillings in your teeth with you when you go. That's staying here on the earth, but your soul and your spirit are eternal and will go on into eternity without the natural things that you accumulate here on the earth. So we got to understand that we're just passing through. This is not our permanent residence. And if we're going to dwell here, we got to do it the way that God wants us to do it, and that is in faith. So how to dwell here in faith? A couple of principles that I see throughout this story and through the life of Abraham that we can apply to our lives and find out how we can dwell here or how we can be living here, passing through in faith. First one is this. We got to realize this life is temporary. Got to realize that this is not permanent. This life is temporary. It's not final. You heard the old saying, the old phrase, he who dies with the most toys still wins, right? He who dies with the most toys wins. You guys heard that? Okay. Just the front row has? What about the rest of y'all? You guys here today? Did you come to church today? All right? Let's participate. You didn't come to spectate, all right? This is not a spectator sport. You didn't pay for an entry fee for me to entertain you. You are a part of this church, okay? So what you put in is what you're going to get out today, all right? So have you guys heard of that phrase? Yeah. There you are. Good. I'm glad. I thought there was more people than that in church. But I like bumper sticker philosophy. You guys know what that is? That's the wit and wisdom that you'll find on the tailgates and on the bumpers of cars and automobiles that drive by on the road. Now, sometimes I'm very disappointed in people and I say, you guys are foolish, you know, and I didn't drive all this way to look at your bumper sticker to see that. But every now and then, you get a little gem. And I was driving one day and I saw one of those bumper stickers, so I sped up and I read the bumper sticker to get the bumper sticker philosophy, and it was so funny and so catchy, it just caught a hold of my attention. It said this, he who dies with the most toys, ... still dies. The percentage is the same, guys. 100% of people who live on this planet will die, okay? Unless Jesus comes back, but even at that, we're not going to have this same residence. This life is temporary. We may not all die, but we will all be changed, the Bible says. And so we need to understand that I'm not putting stock in stuff here on the earth. That's why Abraham dwelt in tents. It's because he realized he was just passing through. Jesus, in fact, did the same thing. If you look at it, you'll find out in John chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God, right? So we identify that there's God, and here's the Word who is with God, but the Word also was God. Verse number 14, you drop down there, and now you find out, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Now I'm going to make you participate once again. Get ready, okay? The Word became flesh. So we know that if the Word was God and the Word became flesh, that means that it's God in the flesh. Who was that?
Jesus.
Perfect Sunday school answer, right? Jesus. So the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Remember, Jesus didn't have a home. He didn't have a permanent residence. In fact, when somebody said, Jesus, I want to follow you, he said, foxes have holes, the birds of the air have nests, but where does the Son of Man lay his head? No place in Jerusalem or Israel. Dr. Barron and Lisa just got back from a trip there. You guys didn't find his permanent house, his dwelling. You may have found Peter's house, right? You found the high priest's house. But Jesus' house is not there. He didn't have a permanent residence. He was just passing through. Now, that word dwell, I've highlighted up on the overhead. It's a very interesting word. It does not mean sojourner like we saw as Abraham was. The original language actually says that the word became flesh, and if you wanted to translate it literally, you find and tabernacled among us. And you might be thinking, taber what? Tabernacled. It was the tent in the wilderness of the Old Testament that you find that the children of Israel took with them everywhere they went that housed the presence of God. So here is God being housed in a tabernacle or in a tent. The word became flesh and tented among us. Jesus just had the tent of his body because he was just passing through. He came, he suffered, he died, he was buried, he was raised again, and then he ascended to heaven, now in his eternal dwelling, seated at the right hand of God. For us, it's no different. We cannot get our eyes caught on what is temporary here on the earth. We got to realize this life is just temporary. This is just a little moment. Now to better illustrate this point, I want you for a second to think about this, all right? I want you to think about a white blank screen, all right? You got that in your thinking? If you have to close your eyes, go ahead and close your eyes. Okay, get the white screen. You got a big white screen, okay? Just goes on forever and ever. Now draw a line across that white screen that goes on infinitely in one direction and infinitely in the other direction, okay? You got the line? It's going on forever and ever, both directions, okay? Now this is gonna bake your noodle. You ready for this? Pick any point on that line. That's the center. Isn't that crazy? Any point on that line, that's the center. Now, think about this. God says that he has limited man's days to 120 years. That's all you got. Moses came along in Psalm chapter number 90, and he said, Lord, teach us to number our days aright, that we have a heart of wisdom, because all we got is 70 years, 80 if we have the strength. So we need to understand and recognize and realize that in the eternal scheme of things, that one little dot is all you got. Are you listening today? That's temporary. And yet we put so much stock into here and now. We put so much effort into what we have right now. We put so much energy and fight and prayer into the things that are right now. And yet God is saying, get your eyes off of right now. This is temporary. It's a little speck on a line of eternity. You've got forever and ever to think about, so you better be ready there. That's where your focus should be. That's where your aim should be. That's where every energy and every effort should be poured into. That's what life is all about. Let's look at it in the word 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Turn there with me. 2 Corinthians chapter number 4, and kind of go towards the end, okay? While you're turning there, I'm going to read you verse number 16. We don't have this up on the overheads unless the guys heard me read it and put it up for me this service, because they're so cool. Let's see. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, starting verse 16 says, therefore, we do not lose heart. They're cool anyways. I love them. Even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. Verse 17, they got this one. For our light affliction. Everybody say light affliction. Wait a second, preacher. You don't know what I came in here today with. You don't know the life I'm living right now. It's hard. You don't know the neighborhood that I live in. Gunfire at night. People dying on the corner. Stuff's taking place. Somebody just stole my car out of my driveway. You don't know the pressures that I got. Light affliction, please. Pastor, you don't understand. My husband beat me and the kids up on our way to church this morning. See, that stuff happens. We have people coming with bloody lips, bloody noses, swollen eyes, black eyes coming into church. Got beat up because they wanted to go to church. Pastor, you don't understand. She left me. I think she's sleeping with someone else. I haven't had sleep in weeks because I've been wondering if I'm going to lose my job. Pastor, light affliction, are you kidding me? For our light affliction, which is but for a moment. It's a dot on a line of eternity. That's all it is. And it doesn't matter how much trouble, how much pain, how much trial you go through, when you think about eternity and how long eternity is and that little speck on the line, my goodness, doesn't matter what happens to me here and now. What matters is my eternity. Come on, somebody, think about it. And yet we put so much stock into things which are temporary. Hoping that the government comes through, hoping that somebody's gonna take care of us, hoping that something's gonna happen, hoping for all this stuff, hoping that we can build up enough wealth to take care of us in our retirement days. God says, get your eyes off of those things. It doesn't matter, come famine or flood, lift up your eyes because your redemption draws near and he is eternal. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working in us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. You know what glory is? That's the manifested goodness of God. That's the appearing of the goodness of God. See, it may appear bad right now. It may not look too good. Skies on the horizon might be cloudy, and yet God says that there is a sun behind those clouds that will break through, and your dawn will shine forth as a noonday, and that God is going to bring about and reveal his goodness, not just here on earth. You'll have that, but guess what? For eternity, we'll be praising God for the great things which he has done. Hallelujah. Verse 18, while we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Chapter 5, verse number 1. Look at this. For we know. Everybody say we know. When the Bible says we know something, we ought to know it, right? For we know that if our earthly house, and then he defines it, this tent, is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Come on. This is good news for all of us. This tent is temporary. Doesn't matter if you don't like the way you look. You're going to discard this tent anyways. Say, Pastor, the tent is breaking down. We got a couple tears. It's starting to wrinkle and the iron's not working on it. Hello. The color's starting to fade a little bit here. My wife cuts my hair. Every time she cuts my hair, she reminds me how much gray is starting to show up. I said, honey, I don't even like you right now. Just keep cutting the hair and be quiet, you know? Well, you got to start dyeing it now so that people don't know when I'm not dyeing nothing, girl. I'm getting rid of this tent. God's got a new upgraded model for me in heaven that can walk through walls, that can transport, come on, what's heaven going to be like? If Jesus can show up in the midst of a locked room, and if Philip can be in one place preaching and all of a sudden beam me up, Jesus, he's in another place, what is my body in heaven going to be like? God's got great things in store for us. There is an eternal weight of glory that's coming our way. Hallelujah. We're going to live here by faith. How to dwell here in faith. Number one is realize this tent is temporary. This life is temporary. Second thing for today is this. Don't get attached. Don't get attached. Like the farmer who told his children, don't name the animals. I already got names for all the piglets. Bacon, ham hocks. Pork chop. Name the chickens KFC, right? Don't get attached, kids. It's temporary. They're only staying for a little while. Something's going to happen. See, in our life, it's easy to get attached. We say, it's good here, God. See, as much pain and sorrows can be here on the planet, as many good things can be here on the planet, too. And it's easy to get attached. I like it here, Lord. In fact, when I used to think about Jesus' return, you know, I'd be reading in Revelation or be reading about it, you know, in Thessalonians, talking about the coming of the Lord. I'd almost have that little apprehension in my heart. Like, Jesus, I want you to come, just not right now. Can I be honest with you? I'm having too much fun, Jesus. There are places I haven't seen yet. I want to go. I want to travel. I want to go. Take a look at that. You know, I'd like to have fun doing that. There's stuff I want to do with my wife. My children haven't grown up yet, Lord. I haven't been a grandpa yet. I'd like to see what that's like, God. So you can come back, Lord, but can you just wait a little while? And God had to deal with my immaturity, had to deal with my heart. Say, grow up, son. Think about it for a second. New heavens and the new earth are going to have way better things than what's here on this earth. New heavens and the new earth, my goodness, there's no marriage, no giving in marriage. You're going to be able to hang out with everybody. Hang out with Jesus for eternity. Man, that's awesome. If I come back, your children won't have to go through the sorrows of this world or the pain and suffering you went through or your wife went through. They can just go and be with me. It'd be better if I came now. See, when I realized that, it was like I clicked over and I said, oh, Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. Come on, let's wrap this thing up. Bring in the end time harvest. Come on, open the gates wide and let's get the people in and let's go be with Jesus. I don't care about tomorrow. God, if you come today, I'm happy. not attached. And yet, the way things are, it's easy to get attached. Stuff is sticky, right? Kind of like a tar pit, because it pleases the flesh. Sex and drink and drugs and money and fame and wealth and fortune. The approval and the praise of man is easy to get off of God and off of the eternal onto the temporary. But I like it. I want to do it. It pleases me, God. And God is saying, don't settle for the passing pleasures of sin. Get your eyes off of it. It's temporary, so don't get attached. This is not your permanent residence. First Peter, if you want to turn there with me, past the book of Hebrews, you'll find the book of James, and then you find 1 Peter. 1 Peter. And we're going to chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse number 11. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse number 11 says this. It says, beloved, that's talking to us. We are the beloved, okay? So if you're in the church, you're born again, now you are the beloved. So he's speaking to you. And he says this, beloved, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims, as people that are just passing through. Look at what he says. Abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul. There is a battle going on for your attention. There is something that's coming against you to get you off. That's why the marketing, the media, everything in the world system, the education systems, the politicians, all that stuff is designed to get you so enwrapped and enraptured with the things of this earth that you start to get attached. And yet God is saying, abstain from those fleshly lusts. Now, that doesn't mean you don't know what's going on the earth. You need to know what's going on. You need to be wise. You need to vote. You need to pray. You need to be a part. You need to be a part of the community and that sort of a thing. And yet God says, don't get attached. You are in the world, but you are not of the world. And in this battle for your soul, it would be better for you just to abstain, to not join in, to not enter in at all. See, sometimes Christians get a bad rap. Well, you guys think that you're so holy, you know. You guys, you're just judging everybody, self-righteous, you know, and you don't do any, you don't have any fun. Listen, I got plenty of fun. I had great fun today, jumping up and down, lifting my hands to the Lord, praising God, crying tears. My goodness, those songs had my heart in a place of the Lord. That's fun to me. That's joy to me. When I go home and I'm with my children, my goodness, we just laugh. My wife and I, we're up late talking, just laughing, having a great time. My goodness, I enjoy creation and what God made. I have plenty of fun. I don't need to snort nothing. I don't need to drink nothing. I don't need to go and violate nobody to have fun. That's not fun. That's wrong. And so God says, abstain. You don't have to have sex before marriage. You can wait. Why? Because that pleasure is temporary. I don't have to go out on my wife to have fun. Listen, I got plenty of pleasure in the marriage bed. Hello. See, God says that's pure, that's holy, and I will bless that. God's not going to bless adultery. God doesn't bless those nasty things that the world wants you to think are all cool and they're putting in your face in the movies and television. You can't even watch a commercial anymore without some nastiness jumping up in your face. Listen, I'd rather rip the TV off the wall and throw it in the trash than have that stuff violate my soul. I'll just abstain. I don't need it. Listen, can I tell you how radical I've gotten? Okay, this is not for you. This is for me, all right? But I don't watch no rated R movies, and I'm looking at the PG-13 ratings, looking it up to find out whether or not they're going to violate me before I go. I'm not looking at that. I don't listen to other radio stations. I listen to Christian music because what I'm putting in, I'm not getting attached. It's temporary, and I'm not going to allow that tar pit to take me down. I'm going up with Jesus. Come on, somebody. 2 Timothy chapter 2, if you want to turn there with me back past Hebrews, you'll find Philemon and Titus. Then go to 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter number 2. Verse number 3 and verse number 4. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse number 3 starts out and says this, you therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. See, it's not easy to be a Christian. Not a bed of roses. It's not a cakewalk. It's tough. There's a war that's going on, and it's designed to come against you. Now look at the next verse, verse number 4. He says, no one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. Think about our brave men and women who are traveling all over the world, protecting our freedoms. What if they were in the tanks and they were making a line and they were advancing the front lines, right, going against the enemy? And as they're advancing, all of a sudden, one of the guys up in the top of the tank looked over and said, "Hey, guys, there's a restaurant. Let's stop in. Anybody hungry? You hungry? Let's go. Let's go get some food." And they stop the tank out there. They park it, right? And they go inside the restaurant, sit down, and, "Hey, how you doing? Can we get some drinks and maybe a couple appetizers? You got mozzarella sticks, you know?" And they're calling them all over, having a good old time. You know what's going to happen while they're sitting there, right? Enemy is going to wipe them out. They're going to steal the tank. They're going to blow up everything and take over, and we're going to lose the battles. And yet, oftentimes, we do the very same thing. Because we get enraptured with the things of this earth. "Oh, look at this, look at that, look at what's going on over here. Oh, there's this event, there's this thing going on. This is huge. Why isn't anybody doing anything here? And what's going on there?" And yet God says, don't get attached. You are in the world, but you are not of the world. You are just passing through. And now don't get involved in that stuff. Don't get entangled with that stuff. Entangled with the affairs of this life. You are on mission. When you see things going on, you are to pray. You are to speak the word of God. You are to believe God for great things. You're to tell someone about Jesus and enlist as many people as you can while you're here on the earth. Can you say amen to that? Amen. Last thing for today. How to dwell here in faith. First one is realize this tent is temporary. Second thing is to not get attached. Final one for today is this: know your future secure. You gotta know this, you gotta understand, you gotta believe God. See, as Christians, we have hope, the hope of glory, Christ in us, that God has given us his spirit, and now our future is secure. That means that we should not judge tomorrow's glory by today's problems. You cannot size up tomorrow's advantages and benefits by what's going on today, here and now. Don't do it. Don't judge tomorrow by today. Why? Today's tough. Today's hard. Today's a battle. Today's a fight. And yet God says that on into eternity, that there is great things ahead of us. That our tomorrow, both here on the earth and in the future, will be great. God is working in us all things together for the good of those that love the Lord and who are called according to his purpose. God has plans. God's working it out. God's working behind the scenes. And those things which you see here in the natural, those things are temporary. But the things which you don't see are eternal. God is doing something great on your behalf. Romans chapter 8, turn there with me, Romans chapter 8, verse number 18. Romans chapter 8, verse number 18, very similar to what we read in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Romans chapter 8, verse number 18 says this. It says, "For I consider," the great apostle writes, "I consider." That word consider really means to reckon. It means to take all the facts and add them all up together. And after you add everything all up, that you come to a conclusion about something. So the apostle Paul, when he looked at life, and remember, this guy went through some stuff, right? This is the apostle that when he started to preach, after he starts to preach, people are wanting to kill him. In fact, it got so intense, they had to lower him in a basket out of a window just so that the people couldn't get a hold of him. He had to be snuck outside. Then what happens? He's almost in exile. People aren't one to talk to him. They're afraid of him. They're waiting to see if he's real because they think he's going to drag him out and lock him up in prison. And so he continues to preach everywhere he preaches. His own people are casting him out. His own people are getting angry. There's riots breaking out everywhere. They drag him outside the city and stone him to death. Thank goodness the disciples come around him and they raise him up once again, right? And so here's this guy. He's been stoned. He's been beaten. There's riots breaking out. And if that's not enough, he's shipwrecked. He's in the deep for 3 nights. That means he's just floating out there in the ocean. Eventually, he makes it to land, and what happens? He starts to warm himself up by a fire, and a snake bites him. Come on, God, are you kidding me? Is this what I signed up for? Eventually, he goes back home, and a riot breaks out. There's people who are fasting, waiting to kill him. I don't know about you, but that's a bad day, right? That is just, that is a bad, bad day. And he spends years in prisons, in jails, persecutions, trial, pain. And yet, this man who went through all that says, after I added up all the facts, and when I looked at life, and when I looked at eternity, I consider the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. See, what is he saying? He's saying, don't even calculate, don't even put that on the scale. It's not even going to weigh up. Because if you look at the glory of God that will be revealed in us, and you look at this teeny tiny little trial, this passing hardship, and you tried to put that on the scale, it wouldn't even register. See, in our life, we need to recognize and realize we cannot judge tomorrow's glory by today's trials. God is working in us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. We need to get our eyes off of the natural and off of the now. See, it doesn't matter about where you dwell. It matters where he dwells. See, we get our eyes on all this stuff. Well, I don't have a big enough house or a nice enough car or, you know, I don't got enough friends. See, it doesn't matter. Doesn't matter what you do in the tent of this body, what you have or don't have. That's not what's important. What is important is where does God dwell? 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse number 16 says, do you not know that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? See, when you gave your heart and life to Jesus, there was a great exchange that took place. See, this man, this outward appearance, this tent, that's not the real you. The real you lives on the inside. You are a spirit man that has a soul. You have a mind, will, and emotions that lives in a body. And that spirit man is the one that died when you entered into sin. But then when you said yes to Jesus and the light of the gospel shone in your heart, and now that spirit man was born again. Now all of a sudden that great exchange took place. The Bible says our present reality is that we are seated with Christ in heavenly places. Right now, I am seated with Christ in heavenly places. I am with Jesus. Right now, I am in him. But guess what else? He is in me. Now the exchange takes place and the Spirit of God comes and lives on the inside of you. That's why the voice of your conscience now is the Spirit of God speaking to you. You, everywhere you go, have the Spirit of God with you. Every place, every time, every test, every trial, Jesus is living on the inside of you and he's speaking to you. He's giving you the wisdom. He's giving you the vision. He's giving you the grace. He's giving you the strength. He's giving you everything you have. So it's not about where you dwell, not about where you go. It's about where he dwells because the Spirit of God is living on the inside of you. Come on, that's good news. It's good news. You never have to be afraid. Never have to wonder if you're alone. God is with you everywhere you go. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 13 says, nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. It said that there's three huge gates that lead into the Cathedral of Milan. Over one gate, there's an inscription in marble under a beautiful flower bouquet that says, the things that please are temporary. Over the second gate, there's a cross with this inscription, the things that disturb us are temporary. And in the central gate, there's a large inscription saying, eternal are the important ones. For all of us, we need to understand how to dwell here in faith. I took all three of our points today, and I added them all together into one sentence. I'm going to put it up on the overheads for you guys. I want you to read it with me. It says this, okay? This life is temporary, so we don't get attached. Because our future is secure. Can you read that with me? This life is temporary, so we don't get attached because our future is secure. Let's read it again. This life is temporary, so we don't get attached because our future is secure. Come on, say it like you mean it. Speak to your situation right now. This life is temporary, so we don't get attached because our future is secure. If you got something from the word today, come on, give God a great big praise. Hallelujah. Hey, let's talk. Let's talk about your life before you leave this place. I want to make sure that your heart is right with God and that your eternity is headed in the right direction. Because there's only one or two places you're going to go when you discard this tent and you head towards eternity. One or two places, either heaven or hell. Now, a lot of times people don't like that. They say, oh, I'm offended by that word hell. You know, I don't think it's real. I think it's just a story parents made up to scare their children into being good. And yet, you know your Bible talks about hell, right? Old and New Testament. Jesus himself spoke of hell. It's a very real place. And just by ignoring it, isn't going to make it go away. You can't just bury your head in the sand and expect it to pass by you. No, you're going to have to deal with the reality of it. And I want to make sure that you don't go there. You want to make sure you don't go there. But did you know most of all, God wants to make sure. That's why he sent Jesus, beaten, bloody, and hung on a cross, so that you didn't have to go to hell. And yet, God loves us so much that he gave us free will choice to choose while we're here on the earth with our time where we end up. Very important, that little dot on that line that we talked about. This is all you've got, not coming back as a frog or a dog or working your way back up to a human. Doesn't work like that. You've got now to make this decision. We're not even guaranteed tomorrow. And so I want to talk to you about your eternity. I want to talk to you about your life. So everybody give me some of your attention for the next couple of minutes, and then I'll let you go. What makes you think you're going to heaven? Sometimes people say, well, I'm going to heaven because all roads lead to heaven, Pastor. You know, after Jesus went to the cross, the door was swung wide open. You know, anybody can get in, and whatever you want to do, whatever I want to do, as long as we stay true to ourselves. Churches out there, they got their thing. That's cool with God. We'll all meet up there in heaven somehow or another. But do you know that goes against what the Bible says? The Bible says the way is narrow and there are few who find it. It's hard to get into the kingdom of heaven. And the way to destruction, that way is wide. But the way into heaven is narrow. There's only one way you're going to get to heaven. Let's apply that logic. All roads lead to heaven. Let's apply that to the earth for a second. If I came and I told you, hey, all roads lead to the moon, you would say, you're crazy. You could drive around the earth as long as you want and you'll never make it to the moon. So what makes us think all roads lead to heaven? Jesus came and he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. It means it's God's heaven. Got to get there God's way. Can't get there your way. Can't get there my way. Can't get there some well-meaning church committee's way. Got to get there God's way. Don't you think God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the one who wrote the plan of redemption, carried it out in his son Jesus, beaten, bloody, and hung on a cross, don't you think after he does all that, that he would reveal to us how to get to heaven? He does, right here in his word. Sometimes people say, well, that's good news, Pastor, because I know that God lets good people into heaven. I've been really good in my life. I used to be bad. I cleaned up my act. Now I'm good. In fact, I think I finally crossed over. My good outweighs my bad, and God will see that. He'll appreciate that, and he'll let me in. I've been nice to my neighbors, given money to charity, gotten involved in social justice causes, and I think that I'm going to get to heaven because I've been good. But the problem with that thing is, you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say how good you have to be. How good do you have to be? Is there a grading scale? Is there a line that you have to be above? Maybe there's a curve behind the map section that if you're this good, you get to go to heaven. And yet, it's not there. In fact, the standard to get into heaven, if you're getting there based on your goodness, it's perfection. No one's perfect. The only one who is perfect, his name is Jesus. The Bible tells us all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And our goodness compared to God's goodness is like filthy rags, going to get thrown out, not going to get to stay. So come on, let's talk about your life. Some of you said, well, Pastor, you know, I was raised in church. Parents told me we're Christians growing up. They hung a cross or St. Christopher around your neck. Had you baptized a Christian as a child? You went to religious classes like Sunday school, catechism class, maybe Sabbath school class. And you're born in America. America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any other religions. We're not Buddhists, Muslims, Hindus. We're Christians, right? Wrong. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible say that your parents raise you in church, tell you a Christian, that makes you a Christian? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you wear religious jewelry, attend religious classes, be baptized as a Christian as a child, or be born in America, that qualifies you for heaven. It doesn't work like that. And I don't see anywhere in the Bible that God's looking at your life, and if you're not some other religion, that by default, God lumps you into the category of being a Christian, headed for heaven, and denying your presence in hell. Come on, today, let me love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough to tell you the truth and not play games. That's how you think you're going to get to heaven. You're not going to make it. So you say, but Pastor, okay, I get that. But not only when I was a child did I go to church. Here I am sitting in church right now, and I consider myself to be a Christian. Here I am. Doesn't that mean I'm a Christian? Well, listen, you can't just sit in church and call yourself a Christian. That makes you a Christian. Again, let's apply that logic to the earth. What if I said I want to be a Dodger? I went and I bought a Dodger uniform, put it on, drove down to Los Angeles, sat in the Dodgers dugout, brought my bat and my ball, called myself a Dodger, and thought that I was going to get to play in the game. You know what's going to happen? They're going to see me sitting there, drag me out, and lock me up. Why? I'm not a Dodger. Can't just sit in church. Call yourself a Christian. That makes you a Christian. So we say, but Pastor, okay, I get that, but you don't understand. My last church I got involved, I helped out. I sang in the choir, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions in that church. People thought of me as a leader. Taught in the Bible class, even got a membership card to that church. That should count for something, right? Well, while that's great and I'm glad you did those things, just show that to me in the Bible where that gets you into heaven, where you help out, sing in the choir, carry the pastor's Bible, make decisions. People think of you as a leader, you're teaching the Bible class, that gets you into heaven. It doesn't work like that. God is not looking for your membership card to a church before you can enter the gates of heaven. You say, but I know God. Someone told me that if I knew God, I'm a Christian. I know about Jesus and celebrate the resurrection at Easter. Sing the songs at Christmas every year of my life. I could quote scriptures to you, Pastor. Doesn't that mean I'm a Christian because I know God? Well, no. If you'd read your Bible, you know the demons know who Jesus is. They believe that he's the Son of God. They're not Christians. If you read your Bible, you find the devil himself knows who Jesus is and believes he's the Son of God and can quote scriptures out of his mouth, and yet that doesn't qualify him for heaven. So everybody look up here at me for a second. Look right here. This is not about what you have up here in your head. Not about having mental assent towards God, knowing who Jesus is, and that gets you right with God, but rather this is about your heart. Here's a real question today. Have you given God all of your heart? Have you given God all of your life? Because if not, not going to make it. No other way to get there. Jesus said it like this. He said, if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, you must be born again. Now, I know our society's made a mockery out of that term. They raked it to the coals. But listen, let's not let Hollywood books, movies, television, and the internet describe for us what being born again is. Let's let the Bible define for us what being born again is. What does being born again really mean? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, always meant the same thing. It means you've given God all of your heart, and you've given God all of your life. Just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. Last book of the Bible, book of Revelation. Jesus is speaking to a church, just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot, or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Now, those are gross and graphic words from the mouth of Jesus, but what's he talking about? Lukewarm. What's that? Well, it's a little in, little out, a little up, a little down, a little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, you're not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So today, I'm going to give you an opportunity. Jesus made this statement. He said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. So today, your call, your choice. In a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three. And when I say three, I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. You might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. Let's get over that embarrassment today, because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? No one make that trade. Come on. And yet the devil thinks you're so dumb, he's trying to talk you out of it right now. Listen, you tell the devil you're dumb. Go jump in a fiery lake. I'm going on with God today. You ready to get your hand up, acknowledging your need for Jesus. And listen, probably won't even be embarrassed, but even if you are, it's better. We're not judging you, criticizing you, condemning you, trying to trick you, make you look foolish. We've all done this at one point or another. And listen, people around you are rooting you on. So you can do that today in this safe and friendly place. Who should raise your hand in a moment? If you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. Who should raise your hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Come on, today is your day. Make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand? If you're lukewarm in this place, you know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Get ready to get your hand up. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television, in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, come on, put the burger down and get ready to get your hand up. Then you can tell an usher right afterwards or come into the church service. Online, if you're watching, God sees you wherever you're at all over the world. You can lift your hand right now, and then there's a blue button if you minimize your browser screen that says, respond to God, or go to our homepage, rockchurch.com, and there's a button that says, how to know God, and someone will lead you in a prayer wherever you're at. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. Come on, get ready to get your hand up if you need to do this. Let's do it all together. Pop my hands together. That's your cue. Get ready to get your hand up, okay? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now if that's you. There's one, two, three, four, five, six. Thank you. Got you up there. Seven on this side. Eight. Got you over there. Thank you. God bless you. On this side. Nine, ten. Thank you up top. Ten. Anybody else real quick? I got 10 wise people. If I saw you, you can put your hand down. 10, 11. Thank you right there. Got you. Who else today? 11 wise people. Anybody else? There's 12 up there. Got you. Thank you. 12 wise people already. This night didn't embarrass them, and I won't embarrass you. 12. Where you at? Thank you. God bless you. Where? All right, 13. Got you. Thank you. God bless you. Who else today? Need to give God all of your heart. Need to give God all of your life. Anybody else real quick that I did not already see? If that's you and you're sitting there wondering if you should do this, yeah, you should. Go for it. Come on, God's tugging at your heartstrings right now. Thank you. 14. God bless you. Got you right there. You can put your hand down. Thank you. Anybody else? Don't you just feel number 15? Number 15, you're sitting there and saying, my goodness, I wish this guy would shut up. You definitely need to get your hand up right now. Come on. Anybody else real quick? Number 15, come on, just raise it up high. Maybe you weren't thinking that. Maybe you're a little kinder, okay? So come on, if that's you, don't let that hold you back. Anybody else real quick? Number 15, come on, let's go for God today. Anybody else, let's go for God today. If that's you, just raise your hand up high. I just know that you need to get right with God today. And you're saying, Listen, if you're looking to the future with eyes of fear instead of faith, check your heart out right now, if that's you. Anybody else real quick? I'm gonna wrap this thing up and I don't wanna miss you. Anybody else? Anybody else? We're at number 15. Got you right there. God bless you. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise today. Hallelujah. Woo. All right, all 15 of you, number 16, 17, 18, 19, and 20, you should have raised your hand, but you didn't. Hey, it's not too late for you too. Here's what we're going to do. In a moment, we're all going to stand, give a clap and a shout. As we do that, get your stuff, whatever you brought with you to church, coat, purse, sweater, Bible, friend if you need a friend. Would you get in the aisle and meet me up front because we're going to change destinies here today. From the family rooms, if you raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, come on down. You can bring your children. You're welcome. From the foyer, if you raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, just come on into the church service right now. Let's all stand and welcome them. You raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, you come right now. Come on down. Come on down.
Jesus, I believe.
Hallelujah. They're coming. Let's give them a hand as they come.
Jesus, I belong to you. You're the reason that I live.
You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment.
You're the reason that I breathe. Jesus, I believe in you.
All the way up on top, wherever you're at, doesn't matter. Come on down right now. This is your time.
You're the reason that I
They're still coming. They're
You're
still
the
coming. Come on, you can come too.
I breathe.
Make your way to the front right now.
Jesus, I believe in you.
Come on down.
Jesus,
come on down.
I belong to you. You're the reason that I live. You're the reason that I breathe.
All right, hey everybody up front, put a big smile on your face. This is a good thing, this is not a bad thing. Came to give God all of your heart, came to give God all of your life. Even the tears are good, those are tears of joy because there's a new start coming and your future is secure, all right? Now listen, right over here to my right, see this handsome gentleman right here waving at you? This is Pastor Joel, isn't he good looking today? Got the glasses on here, looking good, man. All right, he's a really good guy. Nothing weird's gonna go on, okay? You know, you go to church sometimes, you wonder, are they weird? You already got past this guy, okay? He's cool. He's going to do three things. I'm going to let you know what they are in advance. He's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again. Secondly, he's going to give you some free information, some free literature. Find out what to do next in your walk with God. Now that I'm a Christian, what do I do next, okay? It's easy. It's free. And just take a look through that and help you to get your bearings. What do I do now that I'm a Christian, okay? I'll give you a hint. Get back to church, all right? Third thing he's going to do, he's going to offer you absolutely free. Someone in church, we call a spiritual personal trainer. Can I describe it to you like this? It's a friend who will come alongside you for 5 weeks, teach you five things out of the Bible, help you get strong in the ways of the Lord. It's easy, it's free, and you need to do it. He'll describe how it works, and then he'll let you come right back out, okay? Your friends and family will wait for you. If you guys will make a left turn and follow Pastor Joel right this way. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again, I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.